Éric Duhaime, chef du Parti conservateur.
Éric Duhaime, leader of the Quebec Conservative Party. Good evening. You are a leader of a political party, but you've been many other things, a radio host, political advisor. You've worked internationally, and you've written a number of books. In 2012, The State Against Young People, How Baby Boomers Circumvented the System. In 2013, Free Us from the Unions. 2017, The End of Homosexuality and the Last Gay Person. Your party is very diverse. How would you describe yourself? Well, obviously, as someone who didn't have much of a career plan, all you have to do is look at my CV. That's why I got involved in politics very young. I wanted to do something for others, be involved socially. I was very interested in doing that. When I was at university, I was very focused on the issue of intergenerational equity. Intergenerational equity has always been a huge concern for me. That's why my first book is about the government against the state. I was with Mario Dumont for a while. I came back into politics a little over 2 years ago. That issue is central to what I care about. The thread really throughout has been intergenerational equity. We'll come back to different stages of your life, but I'd like to ask you about yourself. You were born in Laval. You're an only son. Your mother drove school buses. Your father was a metal worker. What was your family like? Had very hardworking parents. We were very close, even though they weren't very educated. My parents gave me everything I needed and wanted. They made sacrifices so I could go to a private school. I learned English. My parents were unilingual francophones. I went to kindergarten in English, so when we went on a trip, I would translate menus from a very young age. I looked after the mail as well when we had to read things or write things. The first book my father read was the book I wrote. He read a page every day with my mother's help. I owe them everything. So education was very important to your parents. You're very well educated. You studied political science? Yes, at the Université de Montréal, then a master's degree in public administration. I started a PhD in economics, but as my mother would say, I'm a dropout. I'd understood that I wouldn't just become a teacher. I didn't want to be too specialized. But I did love studying. I love to learn. But at least you dropped out at the PhD level. Yes, better than dropping out of high school, isn't it? Yes, or primary school. You've had two phases in politics. You were with the Parti Québécois in 2000, then you were with the Canadian Alliance supporting Stockwell Day. In 2003, you stood as part of Mario Dumont's team. How did you go from being a sovereignist to a conservative? There was a lot of constitutional polarization. But I was always more to the right economically. When I was a student, I did an internship at the Fraser Institute, which is a center-right think tank. So I had that concern, as you said. My parents were in small business. They were very sensitive to economic fluctuations. I was in the yes camp for the referendum. But that's when things started to change. I think there was more and more polarization. It was a real turning point in Quebec's history, but I don't think we'll come back to that. Mario Dumont tried to bring people back. He tried to bring federalists and conservatives together in a coalition, but really it's François Legault who benefited from that. Do you think that the sovereignty and the spirit to become independent is done in Quebec? I think the sentiment will always remain, but I think most people have moved on, and you can't really create a country when most of the residents don't want one. I think it's a movement that came to the fore with baby boomers when they were of voting age, and I think it is vanishing with the same generation that started it. In 2005, you left Quebec to work internationally. You worked with a U.S. NGO, the National Institute for Democracy. You traveled to Morocco and Mauritania. What were you doing? I provided technical assistance to the political parties and parliamentarians of those countries. After that, I went to Iraq. It's an NGO that helps countries to become more democratic, countries in transition. So we help parliamentarians, all of them, not just of any given party on the right or left or everything, everybody. You were also in Iraq in 2009. The country was still at war. We know that the person you went to replace, who also worked for the same U.S. NGO, had been killed when her vehicle was blown up. So what made you want to work in a war zone? When you live in a democratic country, you know, all eyes of the world at that point were tuned to Iraq. We thought that it really had a chance of becoming democratic, and that was the goal. Of course, there was some risk, and there was a war. There were attacks when I was there, bombings. I have to say, a bit careless. It was a historic and unique opportunity for me. I was somewhat disappointed when I got there, because I realized how difficult it is to transplant democracy. You can provide support, but you can't force people to put it in place. Here's what I felt at the time. You know, when I came back from Iraq, since then, I've never been able to sleep 8 hours straight. I was really deeply marked by my time in Iraq. I was fine when I was there. It was afterwards when the shock set in. When I was there, I didn't feel threatened. I didn't have any security around. But when I came back, it's like my protective barriers fell, and that's when I felt the shock. So I've gone tame now. I'll never go back to a war zone. When you came back to Quebec in 2010, you decided to use your tremendous talents as a communicator. You worked on Radio X as a radio host. During your time as a radio host, you've often made the headlines for having made controversial comments. Are there things you've said that you've regretted now? Well, you know, I didn't have a career plan, as I said, when I came back from Iraq. I just wanted to get out of a war zone. Back in Quebec, I ran into a journalist I knew. He asked me what I was doing. Canadians hadn't taken part in the Iraq war, so there weren't many of us, many Quebecers there. So anyway, I wrote an article through him, and then I was asked to write more. A number of media started asking me to write things for them on a freelance basis. It just kind of happened. I never picked up the phone to try and get that work. When it comes to controversial remarks, you know, when you're doing 4 hours of live radio every day, you can say all kinds of stupid things. I don't think I'm an exception. Yeah, when I see that this is called hate action, something hateful, Islamophobia. You know, I think basically the guy who carried a pig's head is getting more criticism than the young jihadis traveling to Syria to make war. Well, you know, this was completely taken out of context. It's very easy to do that to somebody who spends 4 hours a day on live radio. Sometimes, you know, you have things going through your head very quickly. And you're there with a co-host, you want to feed the debate, you want people to call in, you want people listening to be made to think. So yeah, sometimes we lay it on a bit thick. It sounds quite bad, taken out of context years later, but you know, that's what made the radio show popular. You said you would say stupid things, so it's easy to say stupid things when you're live for 4 hours. You know, when I wrote things, I also wrote a lot of columns for dailies. That's different because you can reread your column and you can be more nuanced and you can make sure you use the right words. When you're alive and the word gets away from you, you can't get it back. It's gone out. It's out there. Your controversial remarks did garner you a lot of criticisms. A lot of people called you toxic, that you were spreading lies, that you would say things knowing they were absolutely untrue. What's your response to your critics? Because you have quite a few. You know, if you're afraid of being criticized, you just can't go into politics. If you don't want to be criticized, stay out of politics, because it's really not the right place for you, be it for that or for other things. A lot of people criticize me for other things, too. As soon as you try to change things in society, or as soon as you want to put forward ideas and you're starting to have some kind of impact, then people who want to keep things the same are going to try and keep you down. A lot of people, well, most people in politics are really warriors by nature. You know, I don't really like controversy or fighting. People who know me know exactly what I'm like. I don't get into controversy outside politics. In November 2020, you announced that you would run for leadership of the Quebec Conservative Party. That has never been a very successful party. It only got about 1% of the popular vote in Quebec, never had a seat in the National Assembly. So what made you run for that leadership? Well, historically, it has deep roots. 8 prime ministers have been conservatives. 8 premiers have been conservative, I should say. But lately, no. So why did I come back into politics? I am center-right, and there was a health crisis. It changed a lot of people's lives. When we look back in 10 years, we're going to see what a turning point this has been in our lives. And that's what happened to me. I couldn't accept that democracy was being put on hold, that historic civic rights were being put on hold, that people's fundamental freedoms were being put on hold. The response to the crisis seemed outrageous to me. And I thought I was completely alone. It was very difficult to say what I wanted to say, because 75% of everybody's salaries were being subsidized by the federal government, and the only people making any public announcements were the government of Quebec saying, cough into your elbow and wash your hands. After 10 or 11 years, I decided to leave radio. And my goal in doing that, really, when I left in July, was to go into alternative media. But come October, when the then leader of the Quebec Conservative Party resigned, I thought about it for a month, and then I had to convince my spouse, because he absolutely didn't want me to go back into politics. When we met 10, 12 years ago, he said, please, you'll never go back into politics. And I said, no, never. I'll never going back there. I'm much happier in the media. I'm better paid, and nobody bugs me. Unfortunately, you know, life happens. And I convinced him, because you can't do this if you don't have the support of your spouse, because there'll always be tension at home. If he said no, I wouldn't have done it. He said yes, and I did go for it. And, you know, in Quebec's history, we've never seen a party go from 1% to 13% of the popular vote. Yes, because you were so well known, you got much more visibility for the Conservative Party, and 13% of the popular vote, from 1 to 13%, that's quite something. But still, no seats in the National Assembly. So now that you can look back on it, what would you have done different? Well, I knew that there was no guarantee of any political success. I thought we would actually go from 1% to 3 or 4% of the popular vote. I thought in some ridings we might even come second. Those were my ambitions. I never thought I could get more than 10% of the popular vote in my riding. I was being realistic. But, you know, when the plane takes off, you don't know how high it'll climb. And it climbed and climbed and climbed. Before the elections, I thought we could make a bit of a breakthrough. I didn't think we'd make government, we'd be able to form government, but I thought at least one or two seats was a possibility. There is no time in history when a party with more than 6% didn't have a single seat. We got 13% of the popular vote and we don't have a single seat. Isn't that frustrating? Yes, it's tremendously frustrating. We had a premier who promised to reform the electoral system. I made a commitment not to start a debate on the voting system, and I'm not going to do that. In fact, he did everything and is doing everything he can to try to stop me from having an office at the National Assembly or doing press conferences at the National Assembly. I convinced 530,000 Quebecers to vote for me, almost as many votes as the PQ in Quebec Solidaire. My card's been deactivated. I can't get into the National Assembly. That is so disappointing. I voted for the CAQ 3 times, but he's not much of a supporter of democracy. A premier like René Lévesque would never, ever have done that. Unfortunately, Mr. Legault is not a head of state. He's the head of a political party, and that's it. Quebec City was about to seize 2 buildings for unpaid taxes. Are there things you could have done differently? I was expecting that. As a center-right party, it's obvious that the traditional media didn't support us. In fact, we didn't have many supporters among the media at all. That's actually a euphemism. So I expected a lot of nasty comments. I paid late. I paid my taxes late. I paid my back taxes. I paid everything. I paid the penalties. I paid interest. If you declare losses year after year, you end up at a point where you can't run a house. You can't run a building. What about capital gains? Well, that's if you sell it. What would your capital gains be on other buildings if you were to declare this building and the losses that it's causing? It's as if you've been hiding it. No, I haven't been hiding it. Everybody knows the building belongs to me. I'm hiding nothing. You believe the media are against you? I don't believe it. I can see it. Just follow one press conference and look at how aggressive the questions were during the campaign. Compare those to the questions for any of the other leaders. You were talking about the health crisis, the pandemic, limited freedom. Now that we're coming out of the pandemic, what are the subjects that the Conservative Party cares about? The crisis is over, but the government's desire to curb our freedoms is still there. I think it'll take different forms, but it's still there. So what is bringing Quebecers together, I think, is the desire to say, we need to be free. We need to maintain our individual freedoms. We want those freedoms to be inviolable. We don't want democracy to be put on hold. I think that is what Conservatives care about. At present, we're hearing a lot about the energy crisis, but it's the Conservative Party who will say, no, Mr. Fitzgibbon, you're not going to tell me what I set my thermostat to and what time to run my dishwasher. If we need more energy, let's exploit our extraordinary wealth in Quebec, but we cannot allow the government to play such an interventionist role in our private lives. The center-right battle is going to continue because there is a political vacuum there. Historically, we had the Federalists and the Sovereignists, but we're seeing both those parties doing the worst, having the worst result in the polls they've had in many, many years. So I think we'll be seeing more confrontations between the right and the left. And around the center-right, there's only us. We're the only ones saying we need to exploit our fossil fuels in Quebec. We need not to mortgage the future of upcoming generations. We are the only party saying those things. You're saying you're the only party saying those things. And sometimes I think I'm hearing Pierre Poilievre. A lot of people don't see the difference between the federal and the Quebec Conservative parties. What is the difference? Well, first of all, Pierre Poilievre is somebody I've known for a long time. He's been a personal friend for 20 years. He was a volunteer, and he spent a month on my campaign as a volunteer. I have a lot of political affinities with him. The federal Conservative Party is either in power or in official opposition. And it's been that way for a very long time. That is not the case for Quebec. I'm a Quebecer, I'm a Francophone. The Quebec Conservative Party is very different. Historically, the Conservative Party at the federal level has been a very Anglophone party. And there's the social conservatism aspect. You know my home situation, so obviously I'm not socially conservative. There are important differences between the two parties. Health, for example, in Quebec, I think we go further than the Federal Conservative Party. In Quebec, we think that it's less identity-based. Outside Quebec, sometimes people see the healthcare system as what distinguishes us from the U.S. We don't make that kind of distinction in Quebec. There are rumors saying that you will be moving to federal politics. Is that something that you would be interested in? I don't think so. I think I'm in the right place at the moment. I think the Quebec Conservative Party is growing, and I'd like to continue this adventure. I will vote for Pierre Poilievre. I am a conservative. I'm going to vote conservative federally. Quebecers can vote as they wish. If the federal conservatives ask me to help in their elections, in the elections, I'd be ready to help them. We've been hearing a lot about populism since Donald Trump was elected in 2016 in the U.S. Would you call yourself a populist? You know, some people say that Manon Massé is a populist. She's far from being right-wing, but she's close to the people. She's very involved in the community. She speaks like, you know, the man in the street, as it were. What I was saying about my parents, I'll come back to that for a minute. I always wanted my parents to be involved in political debates. I thought it was great fun to have debates at university and to have interesting dialogues on Marxism and libertarianism with other students. But I always felt that my parents were excluded from that debate. When I was a radio host, I wanted to involve people like that because I thought they should be involved. When we are afraid of people who don't think like us and who are from what we might call the more popular classes, I find that hurts me. I want to use words and express things in a way that will make me understood. According to a Léger poll, 47% of respondents have a poor opinion of you. What do you say to those 47%? Well, the poll is being conducted during one of the most polarized periods that we've had. It was during a health crisis, and I was very clearly on one side of it. And that side wasn't the majority side. The figures reflect that. Now we're moving to something else, and I believe that on other issues, if we talk to them about individual freedoms, democracy, and civil rights, I think a lot of conservatives who had a poor impression of me for one issue might well come back. And, you know, being polarized isn't always a negative thing. Political strategy can be to divide, to have one part of the people with you. That's something Mr. Legault did very successfully. There are other issues. He divided Quebecers on politics, on language, division. Well, you know, it worked out and that I was on the losing side. But I look at polls like everybody else. Of course, polls matter. But I don't decide anything on the basis of polls. For a long time, Quebec did have a bipartisan system, and now we're seeing four opposition parties in the National Assembly who all had about 10% of the vote. Three of them are represented, and not the Conservatives. Do you believe that Quebec will continue further down the path to a multi-party system? You know, nobody has the answer to that yet, but you're right. It really used to fluctuate from blue to red, to blue to red. Blue tended to change its name. It went from social, you know, one conservative party to another. But now Quebecers are voting for one of five different parties. We could be seeing a transition if we are no longer polarized between federalists and sovereignists. We could well find us divided into three or four parties. It would also be a good thing to consider parliamentary reform. The system was built for a two-party system. Now we have five parties. It is absolutely absurd that a party could get 13% of the popular vote, ends up getting nothing. And with just a few thousand more votes, the Liberals have a $5 million research budget, offices, et cetera, et cetera. So that needs to change. I'd like to come back to something you wrote in 2017. It's called The End of Homosexuality and the Last Gay Man. That's the book in which you say that Quebec is one of the most tolerant societies in the world and that you no longer need to fight homophobia in a systematic way. I thought we needed a counterweight to, you know, we always hear, often hear minorities, including gays, talk about being victimized. We have a serious woke culture happening around us. And I wanted to say that not everybody was the subject of discrimination. I've lived in places where the tolerance of homosexuality is not what it is in Montreal. A lot of people wrote how difficult it's been for them, their attempts at suicide because they've been discriminated against, and it's all very sad, and I'm not denying their experiences. I'm just trying to say that not everyone experiences that, and I wanted to show parents that it's not the end of the world. There are people who have not been harmed by being gay, and I think that's where we are in Quebec. It's good to have a positive message. People are very hard on Quebec sometimes, and so am I, but we forget how tolerant a society Quebecers have. I think that's one thing we can be very proud of. We're very tolerant of minorities. Who have been your role models? You know, when I was young, I had two posters in my room. I had Margaret Thatcher, who at the time was the Prime Minister of Great Britain, and René Lévesque, who was the Premier of Quebec. They greatly inspired me when I was young. So politically, they helped me evolve. Margaret Thatcher, because I liked her very clear ideas and her clearly conservative ethos. I also liked the fact that René Lévesque could bring people together. But he was, in a way, quite moderate about his movement. He was profoundly democratic and human, and he could appeal to Quebecers' hearts. What would you say to a young person getting ready to vote for the first time? Well, the first thing I'd say is go vote. You know, the older we get, the more we vote, the younger we are, the less we vote. What discouraged me wasn't so much the Conservative Party's rating. It was the fact that very few young people voted. So we want young people to participate. It's unacceptable that they don't. I've seen young people in other countries put their lives on the line to have the right to vote, and here young people have it and don't. I want young people to think about what matters to their generation. We have elected officials who have been prepared to buy themselves into power by mortgaging the generations that are to come after them. I think that might work electorally, but it is an absolutely appalling approach. So young people are getting poorer than their parents, so it's very important for them to get involved and vote. If you don't play a role in politics, politics will deal with you as it wishes.